I appreciate the inclusion in the letter from the president of the role of first responders and our military as they've responded to these many disasters around our country, from showing up to the shootings to responding to the floods and the fires. It's times like these when we realize how fortunate we are that these men and women are willing to sacrifice their lives, to risk their lives, to protect us. And I fear, like God, we often take them for granted. So I appreciated that remembrance. Paul, in his letter to the church at Philippi, I think may have laid out here a key for us to live lives of gratitude. And so I just want to walk through that. Be full of joy in the Lord. It doesn't say be full of joy for our stuff. It doesn't even say be full of joy for the protections we have or the blessings we've received. It says be full of joy in the Lord. Our joy is connected then to faith and the abiding presence of God in our lives. We can be full of joy, for God is with us. And then it moves to this idea of being considerate. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all that you do. That is, thinking of the needs and perspective of others is a key to gratitude. Thinking of the needs and perspectives of others is a key to gratitude. It really isn't all about you. It really isn't all about me. When we allow ourselves to turn inward and sort of begin focusing on our own stuff, to use the phrase, as if the world, you know, centered on us, it's in those times when our selfishness takes over and ingratitude becomes the element of our personality. But in consideration of others, we recognize the goodness of God in them as well as for ourselves. In the back of our minds is always the foundational awareness that we are loved by God, who has a place prepared for us. We see that in this, remember the Lord is coming soon. Remember the Lord is coming soon. Allow the promise of God's return and the promise of our eternity because of that return to be a foundation upon which we live our lives and out of which we respond to the circumstances of our lives. We can remember each and every day that this promise of God is given for us. This is an assurance that brings hope in the midst of all the circumstances we face. And then we have no need to worry because Almighty God is a loving God to whom we go to for whatever we need. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray. Tell God what you need. He's almighty and he's good and he can provide for us. And so we pray about everything. And then it says, in the midst of that, you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. This peace goes beyond how we interpret the circumstances of our lives. It's an abiding presence. And it's still rooted in the same foundation that eternity is secure, even if today feels like it isn't. Again, as I think about President Trump's proclamation, as I think about the journey we've been through this year as a nation, as I think about the uncertainty of our times, as we think about what's happening in North Korea as we continue to experience ravages of weather. Are we off the hook? Not likely. But we can find peace in the midst of those circumstances, knowing whose we are and knowing that our future is secure. I just want to share with you that I often have trouble with this story of the lepers. Maybe it's because as Israelites, 9 of the 10 were Israelites, they had paid attention in Hebrew school when they were taught Deuteronomy 8, be careful to obey all the commands I am giving you today. Then you will live and multiply, and you will enter and occupy the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness these 40 years, humbling you and testing you to prove your character and to find out whether or not you would obey his commands. Now, why do I bring that up? I guess I bring it up because I think we think the same way. I think we think about, well, is God going to be good to me? Let me think. Have I obeyed him? And then most of us are, you know, astute enough to look in the mirror and go, oh, I kind of messed that thing up. Oh, and then I had that thought. And oh, yeah, I was definitely selfish there. And I didn't go do that thing that I knew God wanted me to do. Yeah, no, I'm in trouble. Why would God bless me when I have failed to be obedient to him? You see, I read that story of the lepers, and I want to answer Jesus' question. Jesus says to the crowd, and he says to the one Samaritan who's returned to give thanks, where are the other 9? And I just want to say, they're doing what you told them to do. I mean, I can completely relate to this. They're standing there. They're asking Jesus to help. And Jesus doesn't say you're healed. He says, go show yourselves to the priest. And that's exactly what they did. And yet Jesus apparently, they're not there, but apparently criticizes them because they haven't come back and given thanks. Now, in my house in the last 24 hours, I've heard my kids say a couple of times to their daughter, can you say thank you? And oh, it's so sweet when she says thank you. And I got to say, you know, 9 out of 10 times she says it. It's pretty impressive. And I'm thinking to myself, my daughter is teaching her daughter to be grateful. She's teaching her good manners, good lifestyle. It's a good idea when someone does something nice for you to say thank you. I have this feeling that it will graduate to something else a little bit later, but we'll just have to see. Now, look at this picture. I wish I could make it bigger for you, but if you could see it up close, one of the things you would see on the face of the 9 lepers running off to the left is joy. They've got smiles on their faces. They're delighted. The one that looks a little bewildered is actually the 10th one who's looking back. He's got a question on his face, like, uh-oh, what am I supposed to do now? Now, for the longest time, I have said to myself, well, of course he does. He's a Samaritan. What's he going to do when he shows up at the priest's? Right? I mean, he's not one of the in guys. He's not even allowed in the temple. So I'm thinking to myself, well, he just doesn't know where to go. And then I started thinking, you know what? His mother might have asked him a couple of times about saying thanks. You see, I think while obedience is something we need to learn and need to do in our lives, especially obedience to God, I think there's something more here. I think there's a first response that goes beyond what you're asked to a recognition of what's happening in your life. How we view the one telling us to do something, giving the order, is a significant factor. If we're afraid, that is, what will happen if I don't do what they told me to do, we're going to have certain attitude in our heart. If we feel like they're controlling us, that they have power over us, that is, I have no choice, which, by the way, is rarely true, but often felt. But when we realize that the quote-unquote order is coming from someone who loves us and both wants and knows the very best for us, then all of a sudden we can view what they're asking us to do as privilege and gift. Most of the young people I talk to, and when I was young myself, who are thinking about ministry, and I saw this, by the way, on Sarah Marshall's face on Sunday when someone said to her, what about 6 years before you can take Pastor Jim's job here, something like that? The suggestion that maybe you would consider being a pastor is like, I don't think so. It's kind of overwhelming. And it's not just about being a pastor. The truth is, when you hear me, and you hear me all the time, talk about the fact that you are an ambassador for Christ, that you are called to be his witness in your life and in your world, you often feel inadequate to the task. And yet, you know, the Bible says, go and be my witness. And my question is, how do you hear it? Do you hear it as an unreasonable demand? Something that God is asking you to do that you're not really capable of? Do you respond as if, well, it's up to you. You can choose what you want to do and what you'd like. You know, you're the God of God. That's an interesting idea, but sometimes we respond that way. Or do you recognize the immensity of the privilege that God has granted you to go and represent him in the world? When I think about our ambassadors, I want ambassadors who are proud to represent our country as they engage with leaders and others in other countries. It's the same thing with us. God gives us the privilege of serving him. It's a gift. And therefore, when God's asked us to do something, the first response isn't to do it. What is the first response? To thank him for the privilege. To thank him for the gift and the blessing that he offers to us. Now, I don't imagine that Kristen or Bryce will ever be completely successful at getting Isla to say thank you for punishment. I just don't expect it to happen, mostly because it still hasn't happened for me, so why would I expect it to happen for them? But I think eventually she'll probably change her question to, can you say thank you, to, what do you say? At least that's what will happen if what happened in our house happened. Because you're expecting them to know then, after having heard, can you say thank you, so many times, that the appropriate response to that little nudge from mom and dad to remind you to say thank you is, in fact, to say thank you. It's possible. It's possible that anywhere and everywhere in our lives, and especially in our Christian lives, there's always this answer. it's possible that unlike the commercial that you've seen probably on television, have you seen the Geico commercial that everyone, they get in these weird situations and they're about to be killed for something, and do you have any last words? And they say, well, you can save 10% on your auto insurance if you buy a Geico. Maybe the real response is in those circumstances is to say, thank you. Maybe in fact, as Christian people, gratitude is always the first response. Now, there are times in my life when I'm forced to stand up here and preach these sermons that God has asked me to preach, when I'm fully aware that I should just as easily be sitting in the pew hearing it, because I know I personally need to be more quick to respond as a first response with gratitude. But if there's any day to remember that, it's today, tomorrow. And so I hope as you think about the challenges that you face tomorrow, I hope as you think about the joyful things you face tomorrow, I think as you come into Friday and you start saying goodbye to people and you're wishing they wouldn't leave, I'm hoping your heart is filled with gratitude, knowing that you have the peace and presence of God as the foundation for your life. In whatever way you need to say it, I encourage you, I encourage us to be a people of gratitude. Thanks be to God. Amen.